I am Bill Courtwright with Living Right with Bill Courtwright, and this is the Stress Mastery Podcast, where we take you from the science to the spirituality of stress mastery.
Hello, and welcome to another episode of the Stress Mastery Podcast. I am your host, Bill Courtwright, and I'm here with that one and only super millennial, David Barreto, giving us the millennial perspective. Big Dave, how are you doing today, buddy? I'm going wonderful, man. I've had a great day of production.
That's good. I can tell.
had a good working day. So this week, our topic has been despair and grief energy. And today's Connection Thursday, we're going to discuss living from and through the heart. Before we get started, Big Dave, any announcements?
Just one announcement. The higher goal setting course that we did, we completed this week. The recording will be live today if you are listening to this podcast. All the documents, the recordings, the Q&A, everything is in that course. So click courses inside of the community, go to higher goal setting course. It'll say 1 out of 3. You click it, it has all 3 of them in there. Like I said, every single thing. So if you missed any of them, the resources, the videos, everything is in there.
So that course, you will have, when you go into that course, there are 4 books. You'll have the awareness book, which is teaching you the science and the whole structure behind everything. And then there's 3 action parts to it. You'll have the first action parts doing the wants. The second action part would be doing that is connecting to desire. And then the last one is one we just finished, will be intention. And so that's the entire whole higher goal setting process and the process of setting identity-based goals. You guys, if you haven't done it, you'll want to go to work on that and do your best to have it done before you go into the new year, if possible. So this week, our topic has been despair and grief energy. And today we're going to have a discussion on living through the heart. So there are studies and reports that it actually takes 5 to 8 years on the average to recover from a devastating loss. Please let this sink in for a moment. How many out there do you know are experiencing devastating loss since the pandemic? Loss of loved ones, friends, loss of job security, loss of health or fear of losing health, loss of relationships, loss of connection to people, even loss of one's belief systems. See, this all can put an individual into the state of grief, which creates despair and loss of hope, and which, if you maintain this state, will lead to apathy state. And this is when the individual feels hopeless, can't move on, and feels righteous of why they can't move on. And this is what puts people into anger and resentment and regret and guilt. And these people actually start to begin to believe they're entitled to be taken care of. And when this happens, you lose the ability to be responsible. So if you're listening to this particular episode and are stuck in grief because of a loss or know someone stuck, please share this episode. Because if you don't get the awareness of grief energy, you could spend the next 8 years of your life feeling helpless and living what we call a victim story. So what are your thoughts on that,
Dave? Yeah, I think the experience of loss, you don't understand it until you actually go through it, especially when it's somebody that close, somebody that's part of your daily routine or even weekly routine. Because you'll hear people, you know, through the entire pandemic, like you said, I heard people, I lost this one. And for me, it's just like, I'm sorry, you know, like it didn't directly happen to me. But when it happens and it impacts and shifts your entire world, man, that I could see why, you know, so many people become scattered for so long.
And it's not even like, if you think about it, we're talking loss, right? It's not even a loss of losing a person. Let's say you have a job, you've been there for decades, and you have all, you believe, you have this belief system, I have security, and it's gone. And you're, you know, so these losses, what we're talking about, can put us in a state of grief, and it could take up to 8 years. I thought, I was shocked when I studied this, and it starts making you feel like you're helpless, you know, and you're living in this victim story, and it doesn't have to be that way. That's what we want to talk about today. Because if we look at grief, grief is a stress reaction to something, anything that takes place in the world, our environment, that goes against our belief systems. That's what causes grief. So the ego loves the grief energy because it is a depressive energy and it makes us weak. The ego takes this depressive state and creates a victim story. So the ego begins this process through thoughts and stories in the mind. And the body supports the mind by making you feel depressed. Statements like, I feel unmotivated and I have no energy. The ego will create repeated statements like these. So you now tell others how you feel. You tell yourself how you feel, and the body responds, and you feel depressed in grief. And this is what creates a victim story. Now the ego takes these statements, I feel unmotivated, I have no energy, I can't, and creates a story. And now you have a story you tell others to justify your behavior of being unmotivated, of being tired, and why you can't. And these stories are told over and over, and they are told to others and other egos that will now support your grief state. And you tell yourself 50,000 times a day why you can't move on. Now you have a victim story that is set, and you live life, and you see life, and you believe life is sad and hopeless, and your behavior, actions, state of health, and your reality will support this. See, we have 50,000 thoughts a day. If you're stuck in a state, the body's going to keep you in that state, support that state, and you're going to have 50,000 thoughts and statements and stories of why you can't. And that's how the ego uses grief. What are your thoughts on all that?
Yeah, I think you touched on an interesting part. So many people think that this wouldn't happen to them, like you said, in any aspect of it. You know, oh, this is my career for the rest of my life, and then boom, company shuts down or something like that. People start to feel vulnerable, I think, when they start experiencing loss, because you never thought it would happen to you, or you didn't have to deal with it. And now all of a sudden, when that kind of crack in the armor starts to show other spots in your life where loss is even possible, people start to feel guilty or grief, like you said, and it hasn't even happened yet. I've seen so many people try to guilt people and say, well, you better go see your grandmother. You don't know how long she has because a grandfather or uncle passed. Now you're feeling guilty or grief for somebody who's still alive now, because you didn't spend time with them, things like that. That kink in the armor of loss is that spiral effect.
And I think we all have to slow down, because the times we live in are really being steeped in loss. We're losing so much. You know, you can see the stores closing. You can see the businesses changing. You can see people getting sick. You can see loss of health, loss of energy. We have so much loss right now. And the challenge with that is if you get stuck in loss, well, then you're going to get stuck in grief. And the truth is, if you desire to make 2022 better than 2021, this cannot happen through the government or through your family or through your religion. It can only happen through you. You can do this. Nobody can do it for you. To move out of grief, to move out of this victim story of can't, you simply must stop living your life through the cage mind, the head, and move into living your life through the creation mind, the heart. And it is as simple as making a decision. That's how simple it is. It's making a decision. When we live our lives through the cage mind, we are locked into the programs, habits, beliefs, perceptions, and expectations of the programs that are set within the mind. So let's start with what our life looks like living first through the cage mind, the head, and then through the creation mind, the heart. Do you have anything you want before I go into that? Is there anything you want to touch on?
No, the one thing I did want to kind of address, because I think the thought of loss always happens to older, you know, generations. Because I feel like we hear that a lot now with, you know, like boomers or things like that. You start getting older. Some of your friends start companies that you worked for when you were younger, no longer there. We talked about it not too long about the factories, you know, back in your hometown or mm-hmm. when we went back, they were gone, you know. For our generation, millennials, even younger, they're experiencing loss so early. How do you think that's going to kind of play in the long run when it comes down to kind of the evolution of the generations?
So I will say this, the statistics show what's happening to your generation and Brett's generation right now is there's large increases of depression. So people are getting stuck, mm-hmm. right? The challenge your generation has is that you were given stories from our generation. And our generation was giving you promises that don't exist anymore. And so what has to happen is exactly what we're going to talk yeah. about today. People are going, you're going to have to rewrite your stories as a millennial, as a Generation Z. You're going to have to rewrite the stories, the cultural stories of society, because the stories you were given do not exist mm-hmm. anymore. The stories of how we live, how we shop, how we exist, everything's changed. Just look at the Christmas yeah. season. Look at it. The stores, mm-hmm. they're different. It's not like it used to be. So that's what I think, to answer your question, is I think it's time to rewrite the stories anyway, but you guys have to rewrite the story or you're going to live in loss and you're going to live depressed.
Yeah. Yeah,
does that make sense? So I think that was a great question. So let's talk about it. So if we look at our life, let's just see what it looks like. First, living from the cage mind to head. Now, I created the term the cage mind because the programs that are held in this mind are protected by the comfort zone and they are created in stasis, designed not to change. It's a cage. The creation mind, I created that term because all change, every single bit of change and growth and expansion happens through the creation mind, which is the heart. The cage mind is the head. So if we look at these two aspects and understand them, it will give you a lot more clarity of what it takes to change. So this should answer your question, David. And it was a great question that you posed. So the vibration we hold is what creates all potential. If we live through the cage mind, the head, we are living in a state of restriction. This is stage 3 of development, socialized mind. And this state is held. In other words, the vibration is held in the base energy of fear. So when you are worried, anxious about anything, that vibration creates the potential of whatever you are worried about to manifest. When one lives from the cage mind, the head, the behaviors, the reactions, and actions are set through the programming held in mind. Now, the heart supports whatever is being held in mind. Life lived through the cage mind, the head, is lived through the ego, through the eyes of the ego. And when we live through this mind, this cuts off the creation mind or the higher heart. So let us slow down and examine this. When we name something, when we label something, the thing named loses its elasticity to be. The thing named becomes locked in. And this is very important to understand. When we live through the eyes of the ego or identity, we are living through perception and we cannot truly see. So if you label or call or name something or someone or a situation as bad, this something, this someone, this situation is locked in and loses its elasticity. In other words, it cannot be good. You cannot see good if it's locked into bad. And let me ask this. If you call something good, what happens when the good thing becomes bad or acts bad or behavior that's supposed to be good goes against what is good or as what you have labeled as good? What happens then? You become disturbed. Does that make sense to you? That's what happens. So understand that potential is knowledge. It is not knowing. You think this is bad, but do you know it's bad? You think this is good, but do you know it's good? When we study and gather knowledge, this is gathered in the cage mind. When we study and gather knowledge, this creates potential. We create the potential to know something, but we can't know it or know anything without experience. And we only have experience when we connect to the heart. So if you live through the cage mind, you must pause and ask yourself, where did I get this knowledge from? Where does it come from? Why do I believe this is good? Or why do I believe this is bad? Ask yourself, do I really know through experience? Or am I living through knowledge, a belief system that was set for me, but not set by me? Does this bring clarity a little bit to the question?
Yeah, especially when you said we have to rewrite it for ourselves. I think that should always be kind of the thought process, you know, for individuals. But as a culture, it's kind of like a mandatory at this point.
Absolutely a mandatory, because to live from the eyes of the ego is to live unconscious. How do you know if this is you? How do you know if you're living through the eyes of the ego? How do you know this is you living that? How do you know that you're doing this? Very simply, you will be stressed out. Mm-hmm. It's that simple. If you're stressed out and you are depressed, you are living through the eyes of the ego. In the stressed out state, we live our lives through the eye of identification, and we live through the label identity of knowledge. And this takes away the elasticity of life. We are locked in, and thus we lose the ability to know. So this is what's happening to your generation and happening to my generation. What we believed to be true is being exposed. We don't know. So now we have to go out and we have to create new experiences. We have to rewrite our scripts. In fact, shift coaching is a process to help the individual to shift, to rise, to untether from the ego and the cage mind. So then we do this so one can become free to know. And this is the connection in the process of living through the heart. So do you understand a little bit now about the cage mind?
No, for sure. And that's why I posed that question, because I feel like a lot of, you know, my peers and people that I see on social media are stuck in this kind of script. And then when they find things that are kind of off the path that may be better, they feel like that's not the right thing because that's not what they were told. So they miss out on opportunities or things that they're actually supposed to be great at because it doesn't fit what they were programmed to do.
In other words, they stay in the cage mind because the cage mind is the base energy of fear. It's restriction, right? So the question now is, how does one live in, from and through the heart? And it begins with understanding the creation mind and the heart's power. Living through the heart is about slow down and living life as it unfolds in the moment. This is what step 7 of stress mastery, finding the now, is all about. When we live through the heart, our body, our mind, and our spirit becomes energized with life energy. In the heart state, our vibration and potential rises into the green zone energies, which moves us into those purple zone energies. Every cell in this state, this vibration, is bathed in a higher magnetic field. Science shows that the heart state, being present, the heart creates a strong magnetic field which extends out in all directions into the space around us. When we are stressed out, the field becomes erratic. It becomes restricted, negative, and we will actually mirror the emotional state held, which is fear, when we are stressed. When we are in a conscious state and connected and living through the heart, the emotional field becomes expansive. In stress, it's restriction. And when we're connected to the heart, it's expansive, creating a magnetic field to attract into our lives higher energy. This is the science behind the law of attraction. There's science behind these things. So, David, what does a life lived from and through the heart actually look like? When one lives through the heart, they know who they truly are. They have the ability and they use this ability to deal with all conflicts. They know their strengths and they know their weaknesses. When one lives through the heart, they do not live in judgment. They stop seeing good or bad, and they slow down in order to connect to awareness so they can know. And there are characteristics to those who live through the heart. One, they will admit they don't have all the answers. Two, they're open to learn another's viewpoint. Three, they actually live with humility, not taking credit for the work they're producing. They don't have a need to get seen or have status or have likes or to even defend and attack their viewpoint. And four, they do not attempt to change others' perceptions because they'll be accepting of viewpoints with a higher understanding. Forgive them, for they do not know. And five, they're able and willing to control, put their ego aside during so-called crises or challenges, or when conflicts are activated. They could be very decisive. That's what I'm looking for. But they will be slow to act until they process. They're not going to jump into going into reaction and response. They will slow down. And six, they can listen without judgment, even though, and this is a big thing, they can see the truth, but they allow the other individual to go through their processes, to go through their life, what they need to learn. But they can listen without judgment. And seven, and this is the big one, they teach through their behaviors, not their words. That is very important. Do you have any questions on that, what that looks like?
No, I like the distinction you made between the people who say, I don't know, or are willing to learn, versus just the closed out, like, this is my way, this is my thought process. Because those are the people that don't know or are willing to kind of learn are the people I try to surround myself with now, because that's, you know, we always say that we don't know nothing. People look at us weird.
Because the moment you know, mm-hmm. you stop knowing. Because you're stuck in knowledge, which means you're stuck in history and you can't expand. Yeah. You're stuck in restriction. That's the cage mind versus the creation mind. So how do we begin the process of living from and through the heart? That's what we want to talk about, right? And there's really, first and foremost, there's just one thing that must happen. One must make a true decision to change. Most times this takes place when one hits rock bottom or you're just sick and tired of being sick and tired. To change, we must decide to change. And this decision must be ingrained with, I will do whatever it takes. This decision is to let go of anything that does not support life from and through the heart, the creation mind. You cannot live an unhealthy lifestyle and live through the heart. You cannot be in unhealthy relationships and live through the heart. You cannot work without connection to purpose and live through the heart. You cannot start, set the day, live through the day, and not slow down and live through the heart. This decision to live through the heart is to shift one's vibration. Thus, you shift your reality. And you shift your reality to see and live life through a new pair of glasses. If living life through the cage mind is seeing and living through the eyes of the ego, then living and seeing life through the heart and the creation mind is the decision to see and live through the eyes of Christ. This is not a religious teaching. I'm talking about living through the eyes of Christ consciousness. This is about living in a higher vibration to see reality, to see your reality through a new pair of glasses. And it's the first step in creating a shift. When we shift, we see life through a new higher vibration. And this first step is a decision. Before you can do anything, before you can move into living from the head and begin living through the heart, you must decide, I desire to shift my life. I truly desire to change. And if you make that decision to change, you have to be willing to change. I am ready to do whatever it takes to shift. If you get in that decision-making, this is the beginning of the Word made flesh. In other words, your heart's true desire will be manifested. But if you can't make that decision to really change and do whatever it takes to create that shift, then you'll be stuck in your history and you'll be stuck in the cage mind and you'll see life through the eyes of the ego. And when you see life through the eyes of the ego, your reality is in a base of fear. And so you're going to live life in resentment, in regret, and in fear because the eyes of the ego, you're seeing life through the programs mm-hmm. of the ego. To move into the heart, the eye of presence is a whole different aspect of living life. But it begins with a decision. You've got to be willing to change. You don't change mm-hmm. until you change. David, it's yours.
Yeah, I think the decision part of it is like the turning point, you know? The wording, everything you say. I know I made a decision when I started telling myself all the reasons why I could do something instead of all the excuses of why I can't. And that's how I know I was set on my course. You know, we've kind of hinted at a lot of the stuff. I've made decisions now where I've always had an excuse for, you know, years and years and years in the past. And this year I keep on telling myself, this is why I could do this. This is how I can do that. This is why I'm going to do great in that. And I know I've made a decision instead of an excuse. You know, and that was literally a turning point. And you mention it all the time to me. You could see it. You see the difference, all these things. And before, I've always made this declaration, and it kind of deteriorated by the end of the year because all the excuses I put out in the beginning became true.
Yep. When we make declarations, they are wants. They're coming from the ego, right? And I'm talking about this. We're in Christmas season, and we're talking about getting out of grief, right? Listen, my heart goes out to anybody who's stuck in grief energy. If you're stuck in despair, if you're stuck in an apathy state, my heart goes out to you. I understand. I've been there. Now, here's the truth. You're the only one that can get you out of that. There's not anybody else who can get you out of that. Not your significant other, not your partner, not your family. You know, it's only you. But here's what I will say. You can do this. When you create declarations, you're creating projections of what you're going to do. That is not making a decision. Making a decision is really moving in and saying, I will do whatever it takes to accomplish this goal. I'll do whatever it takes to make this change. When you set your life on that course, get ready, because many of the things that stopped you from living that higher life are going to have to be dealt with. Remember the ego, the cage mind. When you live through the eyes of the ego, you are living in resentment. What are those? Those are conflicts that never had a resolution since age 7. You're living in regret. If you live through the eyes of ego, you live in regrets. What's regret? That is grief. That is apathy. That is guilt. But what is it? Those, again, are conflicts that have never been brought to resolution. And those are conflicts in your relationships. This is where you haven't forgiven, whether it's someone else or yourself. And if you're going to live through the eyes of the ego, you're going to live in fear. It's a restriction state, base energies, fear. You have to, because that's the ego's existence. So if you're tired, sick and tired of being stressed out, sick and tired of being afraid, sick and tired of falling short in your life, sick and tired of being depressed, sick and tired of having this resentment, having this anger, sick and tired of being a victim, all right, step on up. Because here we are. We're ready to help you get out of that. But I can't get you out of it. David can't get you out of it. Only you can. Sure, we can help you. Sure, we can support you. But you have to do
it. 100%.
Anything you want to add, Dave? It was a pretty deep one, huh? It is Thursday. All right? So we'll see you tomorrow. We'll continue our book study, The Book of Joy by the Dalai Lama and Archbishop Desmond Tutu. Loving that book, by the way. And by the way, now we're going into the pillars of the book. It's really going to be good. That's it for today's show. Our mission here is to create a shift in the planet. You can join us on this mission by simply like, share, and subscribe. Those links are right below in the show notes. As always, until next time, stay inspired.